Eve, the camera crew come on into the dressing rooms, hang out, be on stage. In fact, Joe Elliott took me on a personal tour of the stage, which we can show that. Can we have a bit of that tape?
Yeah.
We're going to show that to you right now. After that, we'll bring you the world premiere of the new Def Leppard video, Armageddon It. And from now on in, it's all Def Leppard videos up until 9 o'clock Eastern Time when we hit our another special, which is the definitive Def Leppard. First of all, let's take a look at that personalized tour with Joe Elliott of the Def Leppard in the round stage. Def Leppard Bites is sponsored by Close-Up in paste, tartar control, or gel.
As you can see, this is the Def Leppard in the round stage, as seen by hundreds of thousands, hopefully millions of people on this Hysteria tour. Briefly, how is it? We're set up right in the middle of the arena, right? So if you want to pan round, you'll see four sides of audience everywhere. Well, four sides of empty seats, hopefully filled with backsides by the time we go on. Smack bang in the middle, we have legendary one-armed drummer Mr. Rick Allen's kit, which is a series of electronic pads and foot pedals, which has been pretty much documented before, so.
Right!
This rotates, as you can see here, we're on little rollers. I can't do it because it's all machines down underneath in the underworld. This rotates, the stage doesn't rotate, the drums do. We rotate, we move around, but the drums do. So Rick can face that way for a couple of songs and then that way for a couple. And if we feel like being really like on April's Fool Day or something, we can spin him around at 100 mile an hour and watch him shoot off into the back row. These little mirrors here, they're not for us to put makeup on or anything, they're part of the lasers. They all bounce off out of holes. I'll show you the laser hole. This, under here, this little thing lifts out. I can't do it from where I'm stood. This lifts out and the lasers are all down in there and they shine up and bounce off various mirrors, all in the lighting rig. You'll have to find one. There's one. Oops, sorry, there's a mirror. And then they're all over the stage and the beams bounce all over the place and it creates the illusion of being thousands of beams. It's actually one beam that's just bounced all over the place. There's 32 tons of equipment in sound, light and scaffolding flown above us every night. And we are actually stood on 20 tons of equipment. It takes about 4 hours to set it up because we have a very good crew. And it takes about 2.5, 3 hours to strip down, yeah? It takes about 2.5 hours, which is great. And 52 tons of equipment goes in 8 trucks. It's the crew of life. This blows away playing at one end. It's far more fun for us, for a start. As you can see, it's sort of like playing in four theatres all at once. So you get a sort of a theatre atmosphere within an arena. Because when you set up at one end and the back row is 110 yards away, those poor kids can't see anything and we can't see them and, you know, it's sort of binocular time. I think the best seats in the house are actually higher up because they get to see the stage. The kids down the front, they don't get pimped, but they down the front for a purpose. They want to be as close to the band as possible, maybe. But they don't get to see the stage. The kids up in the nosebleeds, they do. And I think they actually get a better view. I would sit up there if I was watching the show, which unfortunately will forever be an impossibility, unless I get kicked out of band, but, you know, I wouldn't come and see him then.
Bringing on the Heartbreaks is one of my favourite tracks of Flying Dry. In fact, it's a track that probably broke us in America. And, one of my favourite solos that I ever did as well. So, here it is.
Bites,
Here's a video that you people out there voted 86 consecutive days the number one most requested video. Shot in Denver, Colorado. This is Pour Some Sugar On Me.
2 weeks after we decided that we had enough songs, it just came up by accident, you know. So I was just playing it on an acoustic, just messing around in the studio, and I think Mutt had gone off for a coffee or something. And he came back in and just asked me what it was, probably thinking it was somebody else, because I normally pick up an acoustic when I'm having a break, start playing on Mott the Opal songs or something, you know. And he said, "What's that?" And I said, "It's just an idea." And he said, "It's pretty good, let's work on it." So 3 or 4 weeks later, we ended up with another song. And we thought, "Oh God, we've got enough songs already." It actually turned out to be like one of the better songs on the album. You hear it.
Here's a video that we shot about 6 years ago now. Yeah. I think it was actually shot on Phil Collins' birthday. He was a mere 25-year-old. And it features one of our managers. He's dressed up in the monk's outfit, and the song is Rock of Ages.
While everybody else was putting Bimbos and Ferraris in their videos, we put in rhinoceros. So here's Animal.
Of all the videos we've done for the Astera album were fun to do. I think, you know, they're videos come a long way, you know, in making videos, since we've done like Pyromania stuff and everything. And the actual track Hysteria was really, really nice. You know, we had a great location. And, you know, we just got off on being there. So that was really fun. And it was also our very first top 10 single in America.
This next video was the first video we shot for the Pyromania album, and is heavily influenced by one certain Marilyn Monroe. This one is called Photograph.
Going and live with these people in a travelling circus for just a couple of days, and it's like we wanted to try and capture the seedier side of it rather than the glamour and the performance thing. It was like getting involved with the mucking out with the animals and all, like, it's like a bit like a backstage idea of a circus that we wanted to get involved with the old caravans and the straw in the back of the hut and things like that, rather than the glamour side of it. It's because it's basically like a travelling rock band, but it's, I would imagine it's a lot more hard work being in a circus.
I think Love Bites is basically Steve and Phil were just messing around and with Mutt, and we came up, you know, and just came up with it.
I think it was at the stage where we were kind of looking for a more melodic, laid-back ballad-type song, if you like, because I think it always happens that way. We'd probably written 4 fast songs in the last 2 weeks, and we were looking for a slower one. And as Joe says, it just came about with the three of them. Just the initial chords and a couple of the melodies, and then it'll get bounced around. Everybody had chipped their own little bit of ideas in.
Leopard videos we could find for you in our Leopard's Bite special, but the show is not over yet because we still have the definitive Def Leppard. Now, what you're about to see is parts of interviews that were done throughout the years, the interview that I did in Atlanta, Georgia, when the band was touring in America. We left no stone unturned. Of course, Def Leppard is a band that has had its very low points. We talked about those. A lot of high points. Of course, it's going very well with this band in America. Over 7 million records sold in America alone, and around the world, they've just sold out millions and millions, and it's all coming your way in the definitive Def Leppard. You want to watch this so you don't miss one single bit.
We want to be a big band. We have a big outlook.
You can plan ahead, and then all of a sudden you just get a phone call and it's not happening.
for when I finally came round after my accident, I was sort of saying to her, it's okay, you know, things will be fine, don't worry about it.
I do believe that, you know, for every great success you get, you have to go through something to actually get there. And we went through enough to sell millions of records.
Welcome to the Def Leppard stage of life.
I came from Sheffield, which is in England, and I played classical guitar for about a couple of years, and then one day I heard Jimmy Page, and that was it. I just threw the classic guitar through the window. I said, that's what I do, I want to play rock music.
When I was younger, all I wanted to do was play soccer. I didn't have any idea about playing a guitar, really. I remember when I first heard Queen on record, I thought, I want to be in a band that sounds like this.
I think it was the first time I ever saw T-Rex on Top of the Pops in England. I just looked at Mark Bolan and I just went, wow, I want to be that man, you know, I want to be Mark Bolan. Walking home from work one day, having missed the bus, which is a funny thing. Had I caught the bus, I wouldn't be here. I'd missed the bus, I was walking home and I bumped into Pete Willis, our ex-guitar player. He told me he was looking for a singer for a band that he was starting with Sav and a drummer called Tony Kenny. And I just bullheadedly just said, I'll have a go, you know. So he said, okay. So everybody came round to my mum and dad's house and we sat in my bedroom and played the latest Pat Travers album. And whatever, and we just talked about it, and I got the gig.
He looked the part, which we thought was 50% of the thing anyway. And what's that? We were doing, I think, what was it?
Stairway to Heaven.
We did Stairway to Heaven. And he did the first half of the song brilliantly. And then when it went to the heavy section, where it's supposed to go up in at least an octave higher, he kept doing the in the same octave, and it was like,
sounded like Engelbert Humperdinck.
As about, you know, get up there, my son.
I still remember it because it was the most nerve-wracking thing I've ever done. You know, we did it with all the lights turned off, you know, but just like one candle on in the middle of the room or something. And I was singing away, and I just happened to turn around to Sav, and he's playing the bass, and he just went. When we first got together, it was more like something to do at night. It's like our own little youth club. We didn't really even think about playing live for a long time when we first started off. So by the time we did play our first gig, we'd got about 12 original songs written. So we spent a long time in this rehearsal room that used to be a spoon factory, just piecing stuff together and writing it and playing it and playing it and playing it, but not in front of any people. And then we did start doing a few clubs for money. Because this guy came up to us and said, well, guys, you know, if you just do like 2 40-minute sets of some popular tunes, we can get you like £250 a night, which was a lot of money. It would have bought us an amplifier every gig we did. Mm-hmm. So we started doing a few covers, but they were always the rock things. So we were doing Boys Are Back in Town.
We actually did
a Foreigner song once, Hot Blooded. Yeah. We did a lot of UFO stuff, things like Only You Can Rock Me, and we always did 3 or 4 Lizzie songs. But they were the only ones we ever did do, and then it was all our own stuff. And we just used to say, this is a song by a band, you know, and make a name of a band up. It was actually one of ours that we'd tell everybody it wasn't, you know.
Yeah.
Joe came up with the idea. He said, well, why don't we just go and make a record? And so we went in and just cut like 1,000 of this EP, 1,000 records. And we just went in and just sold it to friends. You got to sort of walk into the pub and, yeah, buy this. And then it, somehow it got into the charts. I don't know how that managed to happen. But Joe had sort of go around to the local radio stations and to play this.
And one of the record shops where I'd taken it to, I went back there 3 or 4 days later to see if anybody had bought one. And the guy behind the counter said, well, we sold two, I think. And I listened to it, and I think it's really good. I've got a friend that works for a record company, and we'd like to manage you. And that was the start of the beginning and the end of the
That's right.
We recorded the first album at Starling Studios, which is owned by Ringo Starr in Ascot. And we had a real lot of fun making that record. that's what it sounds like it does.
It's a vague memory just doing the record, because it was the first time. It's like, so this is what it's like to be in the music business, sort of thing.
Oh, I think you drank far too much.
We used to get drunk every night and still try and record, and it's like totally young kids playing at being musicians, you know. I think that's how it sounded to me.
Well, High and Dry is what we all really consider our first LP, because that's the first LP we did with Matt Lang. That's when we really sort of thought we were really creating music and something. We really knew what direction to go in. It was a different sort of sound to what we do now, but we established our roots on that album.
First time we've actually been put in a situation where we've got to sit down and really think about it and really take time and really have a perception of how a certain guitar should sound or the way the snare drum should sound. Whereas, like I say, on the first album, it's like, just record it, you know.
There's a lot to do with meeting up with Matt as
yeah,
well.
I think, you know, Mutt was very responsible in that factor. He was the one that actually taught us that, you know, you have got to structure things and you do have different textures and, you know, the way things sound and stuff. And, you know, he basically brought that out of us, because he was always in there within the band of how we wanted to sound. But Mutt Lange was just like the instigator of getting it out of us, and he knew exactly how to do it.
High and Dry really, that's the one that broke us in the States, especially the track Bringing On The Heartbreak. That's the one that everybody latched onto and eventually went platinum. People were aware that there were a group called Def Leppard, and they didn't say who anymore, you know? It broke us in the States to the point that we got airplay and exposure, and people were aware of the name. It wasn't until Pyromania that it went sort of crazy. During Pyromania, it was quite a long album to make and a bit of a struggle, quite short when you look at Hysteria, but we'd finished all the backing tracks, and there was sort of a distance becoming between Pete and the rest of the group. it was like an attitude thing. He wasn't really that into what we were doing. I think he was getting impatient. It's understandable. And we were sort of losing our patience with him. And there's this bigger and bigger sort of gap emerging. And we just said it would probably be better if you'd leave. And then we'd always had this identity of being a two-guitar band. And suddenly I thought, wow, there's 10 tracks on this album. I don't want to do 10 solos. And I said to Phil, why don't you come out of the studio, or Joe did, and Phil came down and said, why don't you just make a cassette, like three songs, like stage fright, rock till you drop. I said, if you just take like three solos, just as if I'll do the other seven, just to take a little bit of the pressure off. And he never left.
From a production point of view, I suppose when people listen to Pyromania, it was a bit of a blueprint, you know, which is one of the reasons why we spent so long making this last album, because we didn't really want to make a Pyromania 2. I think there are a lot of other bands that have taken care of that.
It took a long time because we wanted to get it right, and we'd been getting it wrong for quite a long time, and it was a case of we didn't want to put out something that was inferior, basically. We didn't even want to put out something that was as good as Pyromania. We wanted to put out something that was twice as good. You know? I mean, we sometimes sat down and laughed about it and said, this is really like our fifth album. Mm. We recorded the fourth, we just didn't bother releasing it. We started off with Jim Steinman as producer, which didn't work out at all. Then we had a go on his own, which was better, but, you know, it was maybe as good as Pyromania, because we were using the engineer that Mutt normally works with, and self-producing. And some of the stuff we actually did actually get kept. We kept some of it. Not a great deal. But then, like, mid-85, after, you know, a much-needed rest, Mutt kind of snuck back in on the project, you know. He just said he'd work on a couple of songs, and eventually came and never went back, you know. It was New Year's Eve. The last thing that you want is bad news, you know. Our manager rang me and told me. It was mid-afternoon, and it was, you know, it was like the worst moment of my life, basically. It was a very difficult thing to come to terms with.
When I finally came round after my accident, I was sort of saying to him, it's okay, you know, things will be fine, don't worry about it, you know. And my parents, I mean, they took it worse than anybody. And obviously, you know, the band, they were, I mean, they didn't know what they were gonna do. You know, they didn't know whether I would be able to play again, you know, all those kinds of things.
There was never any question about us, the four of us, sitting down and saying, right, well,
we better find a new drummer.
We're going to audition.
Never even came up.
Because the last thing on his mind was the record at that moment. You know, we were more interested in just how the guy was, and, you know, and just really happy that the guy was at least alive.
Yeah.
I mean, that was a bonus, because he was like, he was very close to death at one stage.
The weirdest thing was when me and Steve went to visit him in hospital. He was all bandaged up still, you know, on medication. And we walked in and he went, "Hi," as though nothing had happened. And we went, "Oh, he's delirious, the boy's sick, you know," whatever, you know. And he'd been practicing on the edge of the bed with a pillow. He said, "Well, I've lost my left arm, so I'm going to use my left foot and left leg," you know, which really seems logical. And that's exactly what he did.
His name is Rick Allen. We call him the Thunder Gun.
We were just blown away by his determination straight off. You know, he got out of hospital like 6 weeks, and they said he'd be in there for 6 months. And he was just really very strong. And it was good for all of us as well, you know, it made us have a lot more determination, lot more faith, you know, and just everything.
When you're on stage, you don't marvel at his drumming. Because you're oblivious to the fact that he's got one on, the fact that he's there behind you, and as solid as a rock as ever, you know. That is like the biggest compliment, that he's taken for granted. He's just a normal human being. He's just a drummer.
After what happened to me, I think the band actually got closer.
Even though we were working on the record within 3 days of the accident, we spoke to each other on the phone and said, well, listen, there's no point sat around, you know, all morbid and everything. We might as well at least try and get back to work and take us minds off it a little bit, you know.
The song Animal we rewrote 3 times and re-recorded it 3 times in 3 different forms, and it's like, no, it still didn't have that magic. And then one day we just changed the bridge or whatever it was, and it just clicked, and then we knew that we'd done something right. And this happened with a lot of the tracks, and I think that was the main reason why they took so long. It was just getting them so that we were happy with them.
We had so much, right? We ended up with parts of songs that would total about 60 different parts, and then they were whittled down into songs, and we ended up with about 20 songs. And it was kind of difficult to select what should go on the record and what should be left off. But over the period of actually working with the songs, it became more and more apparent what we should be using and what we're going to leave off and use as B-sides. We've never like got a set of lyrics and wrote a song to it. We don't do it that way. To be quite honest, we don't actually attach that much attention to lyrics. It's the way that they sound.
It's skin on skin, let the love begin.
Skin on skin is major impact, and it sounds good. You know, I mean, it could have been pick any 3 one-syllable words, but it wouldn't have sounded as good. You see, it's the sound. I mean, obviously, it has to fit lyrically within the context of the rest of the song, which it does anyway, but that's sometimes why it takes a long time to get it written.
Here we go! Like a lover with a red iPhone, looking like a tram, like a video vamp. Demolition woman, can I be a man?
Pour Some Sugar On Me was the last one to be written. I was just playing it on an acoustic, just messing around in the studio, and I think Mutt had gone off for a coffee or something, and he came back in and just asked me what it was, probably thinking it was somebody else, because I normally pick up an acoustic when I'm having a break, start playing on Mutt the Opal songs or something. And he said, what's that? And I said, it's just an idea. And he said, it's pretty good, let's work on it. So 3 or 4 weeks later, we ended up with another song. And we thought, oh God, we've got enough songs already. It actually turned out to be like one of the better songs on the album.
The longer we went on recording, the harder it was. You know, you get tired, it's going, oh, not this song again, and stuff. And it just makes it real hard. And that's why, you know, we're working slower than we normally would have done. But yeah, in the end it paid off. And in the end it also, it sounded like we imagined it to sound.
I believe in the fact that if you work hard enough, then you eventually get what you deserve, basically. I think any success that we've had, even before 83 and after, I think we've worked for it and we deserve every inch of success that we've got. I do believe that, you know, for every great success you get, you have to go through something to actually get there. And we went through enough to sell millions of records. Work well with each other. I think that's our strong point, you know. And then, and we do get on with each other. It's not like, God, do I have to go on stage and play with this guy again? You know, there's none of that. It's a vibe. It's, you know, it's a good, it's a laugh, and I think that's the most important thing.
Have a good time.
Yeah, my theory is
have a good time all of the time.